From Paul's epistle to the Romans, owe no one anything except to love one another. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. As those of you who have been here before know, I always preach from the gospel. So in today's gospel, it tells us, if you've got a beef with someone because he's wronged you, go to him directly, don't talk about him behind his back. Amen. Now, moving on to the epistle. Owe no one anything except to love one another. I've been challenged in the last few weeks by engaging seven people, one of whom is my wife, because you can't escape those questions, to get back to the basics in the faith formation class that meets on Thursdays at 8. It's challenging because some of these folks were confirmed in the Roman Catholic Church many moons ago, or in the Episcopal Church many moons ago, but never took a class, and so they're taking it. Or grew up in the Presbyterian Church and are finding the Episcopal Church anew. Or, in one case, was a son of a priest in the Episcopal Church and just got sent uptown to get confirmed and doesn't remember a thing about confirmation class. And it's wonderful to have these basic questions asked. I had a conversation earlier this week with someone who was asking me about the basics of, well, what about believing in God and the existence of God? And I was challenged yet again because I do believe in God, and yet I remember a time when I was laid flat, and I've talked about that, because I wasn't sure I did. In fact, I was pretty sure I didn't. And yet I don't remember how I got out of that. It was so long ago, or I wouldn't be standing here today. And so I've spent a lot of this week wrestling with that basic question. And to me, it comes down to three basic questions that I want to wrestle with you today. One, is it all true? Is what we read in the Gospels true? That's the sine qua non, the ne plus ultra. We can't get beyond that. We're not getting any further. Is it all true? And if it is true, what does it mean? It is true. Three, what do we do about it? Well, is it all true? Well, one of the advantages of moving 10 times in 30 years in ministry is you move your books around with you, and there's a winnowing effect. Not all books move. And after this last move to Litchfield, which I plan to be my last, only the good ones survived. This book is by Norman Pittenger and was written in 1941. It seems to be a first edition. And I don't know how it came into my possession, but I found it on the shelf. It's called Christ and Christian Faith by Norman Pittenger, 1941, by some obscure, probably Vanity Press in New York City. And it's from the General Theological Seminary Library, Chelsea Square, New York. And it has a stamp and a succinct way that only librarians know how to do. It simply says, reject. And there's a date, October 13th, 1953. So it was written in 41 and tossed out in 53, and somehow it got into my hands. Well, Dr. Pittenger was born in 05, and he wrote this in 41. He was a professor in the General Seminary from 36 to 66. And most of the men who were priests in my childhood studied under Pittenger. time when most of the professors were Victorians, either by temperament or by chronology, Pittenger was a breath of fresh air because he went back to the basics. Although he was a professor of dogmatic theology, he was anything but dogmatic, and he got down to the basics with people. And so this chapter of a book, which he wrote when he was 37 years old and a new member of the faculty, was entitled Grounds for Faith in Christ. He thought that was important to tackle at a time when no one was questioning it. He questioned it, and he answered it. And I'm not going to read you a lot of it, but I'm going to read you a bit of it, because I think this is what we're really asking. And he sets the stage for it this way. It's a bit thick, the language. He says that the Gospels are mediated, his words, mediated, by which he means they are the impressions, what the experiences of the time meant to the people who wrote the stories down. He also goes on to say, is it even possible for us today to have pure objective fact that isn't mediated by our impressions, by what it means to us? It's a beautiful day, I heard someone say today. I think it feels like the inside of a toilet. Is there an objective fact about whether today is beautiful? No, it's mediated through our impressions. He goes on to say, but that mediation doesn't deny the underlying fact of the Gospels. And he goes on to say this, and I offer this to you. God had indeed visited and redeemed his people. The report is given us in terms of the meaning which Jesus of Nazareth had for his disciples in the early church. It cannot be understood apart from the meaning which it had. It cannot even be known apart from that meaning. And it cannot be explained unless we are prepared also to admit that there must have been some series of events adequate to call it into being. And here's what it was. That a life was lived, a teaching given, a work done, a death died, and what the very first believers declared to be a renewed presence and power known and experienced, the resurrection. Pittenger concludes, the immediate consequence of such a statement is that we are faced with a further question, is that conviction itself a reasonable one? I say to you, it is. It is reasonable that those who experienced the life, death, teaching, death, and new life after death of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who then themselves lived their life in a new way, following a new commandment that you should love one another, and for that were willing to, and to a man, those first 12 died a torturous death for it. That is witness enough for me, right there. Fast forward, or slow forward, 2,000 years, and that series of witness and martyrdom for the faith, and lives transformed and lived anew in the faith, is further witness to the transforming power of Jesus Christ in people's lives. You have seen it, you have felt it. I have been in rooms with open meetings of Alcoholics Anonymous where people have proclaimed that their lives have been resurrected because of it. I have been in deathbeds where people have proclaimed that they're ready because of it. You know in your hearts that whether you believe it or not, you're longing to believe it, which is a pure indicator So if it's true, what does it mean? It means that your life must be different. How must it be different? It must be not lived for yourself alone, but lived for love, as we are told in the Epistle to the Romans. Owe no one anything except to love one another. At the Monastery of the Holy Cross, where I was for a day this week, there is, in calligraphy on the walls, this from the rule of the order: love must act, as light must shine and fire must burn. Love must act, as light must shine and fire must burn. In other words, it's in its very nature that if you have love, you must act. So we are changed into beings that act not only for ourselves, but for others in love. And so what do we do about it? We put that love into action in our words and in our thoughts and the way we live our lives each day. May we do that. May we figure out how to do it in our families and in our parish community and out in the world in which we live and move and have our being, because as St. Paul puts it, owe no